Welcome back, everybody, to the Winter Championship Preliminaries for the Americas region. My name is Frodan, and we have our lower bracket match to decide the second half of the competitors going to compete in the March 11th to 13th finals. So joining me on the desk, we have Raven and Brian Kibler. Kibler, how'd you enjoy that previous series? Were you cheering at Chalky at one point?
Yeah, I mean, it's great to see Chalky advance. He's a player who's had a string of successes over the years, never quite reached sort of the top of the mountain, but great to see him move on and see if he can build upon that success next month.
That's right. A player that's been cursed, so to speak, to get second place for the rest of his life. Maybe not anymore. He's a guy who's advanced to the top eight, and maybe another group of players in his practice group can do the same. He said a big shout out to the Salt Boys who did help him get through. That's just a collection of friends who've really been playing Hearthstone for multiple years outside of their team boundaries. Raven, you've been casting alongside me as well. What are you looking forward to the upcoming match here?
Yeah, I mean, like I said, we just saw Chalky's match, which although was a 3-0, was actually really good. Good set of games. I enjoyed a lot casting. But now we have Amnesiac versus Kit Kats coming up, so I expect nothing less from these guys. The two pros, one quite young versus one of the more older guys in the scene. But yeah, I'm just think it's going to be an amazing match. It's going to be interesting to see who actually makes it.
Okay, taking a look at the classes. Amnesiac, well, I'm sure he's required to bring four classes, otherwise he's fighting at a heavy disadvantage.
Mystery deck.
Yeah.
Well, I guess Conquest, you only you have to win with one of each of your deck one time, so maybe he's at an advantage. Only has to win two games.
Tricky.
We'll see.
Mage is apparently the missing one there. So
All right.
It looks like Kit Kats is choosing to ban out that Rogue, and I suspect that we will perhaps see yet another Freeze Mage from Amnesiac here. He did choose to ban out, I believe, Kit Kats' Warrior. Mm-hmm. So that's definitely a direction you want to go if you do have Freeze Mage in your lineup.
Yeah, a good respect ban as well, because you know Kit Kats can pilot very well. He understands how to play from both sides, the Freeze and the Warrior. And I think it's just interesting because people have been keeping these strategies all tournament long. We've been seeing Kit Kats constantly ban the Rogues. In fact, every series I believe we've seen Kit Kats play on stream, he's been banning a Rogue, which is a shame because we would like to see a little bit of Rogue yep. diversity, but I can understand for his strategy, keeping that consistent with how he wants to play.
Well, that's actually particularly unusual considering he's just played against so many people who've had Rogue in their lineup. That's a, you know, unlikely enough as it is.
Yeah, I think it's interesting as well, like on the other side where the Warrior ban versus Kit Kats, it is aimed based on the lineup as well, but we've seen the same vein as people are playing against Fibonacci where you just ban the class when someone's deemed a specialist in it, just because although it might not be the perfect ban if you looked at the lineups in a vacuum, it's actually just you want to remove one deck that someone's hyper-specialized in just to make them uncomfortable more than anything.
Yeah, I mean, and I think that we have seen, I mean, Kit Kats actually mentioned on Twitter that he felt he was maybe not necessarily playing his other classes to the best of his ability. He is definitely a warrior specialist, and we'll see if that choice from Amnesiac actually pays off.
Amnesiac, on the other hand, a lot of people attribute Druid to his success. He's a player that's climbed to the high ends of Legend multiple times. I don't know how many, but it's definitely more than one. He hit number one Legend. Very accomplished young player. He's also 15 years old. I think a lot of people always emphasize that as his main selling point as a player, right? People are just like, he's only 15 and he's this good. But I think another thing that people don't really realize is how successful he's been helping other people win their events. For a long time, Archon was succeeding in their tournaments largely because of Amnesiac in the background helping build their decks alongside Purple, who everyone knows has went on to a tear at the end of last year.
Yeah, Amnesiac officially joined Archon not all that long ago, actually. Yeah. He's been playing under their banner for a little while. And Kit Kats actually, for a time when the Archon house was in Texas, I believe he was actually living there for a period as well. So he has ties to that organization as well.
Yeah, I think it was interesting as well. When it was announced that Amnesiac joined, it was one of the first things they said where it's like, we've not just picked up this guy out of nowhere. Like, we've actually been practicing with him and he's been helping us for quite a while now. And that speaks volumes, like you said, considering how young he is to be helping out, you know, a team like Archon, which are, you know, pretty top level. It's pretty impressive. And I'm looking forward to it. I've not actually got to cast a match of his before, so I'm looking forward to seeing this game.
Yeah, back when Firebat was on Archon, and even in recent times, he did an interview saying that he thinks Amnesiac is ridiculously good because they would get they play Hearthstone so much they really want to experiment a lot with different formats. So they just come up with the most random rules, like we only can you know, put cars that have beards on it or something, you know, like something stupid like that. But then they would put these ridiculous restrictions, and yet Amnesiac would be very good at beating Firebat even in those scenarios. So he's very good at adapting, understanding what cards are very good. Strong deck builder, great player. He is very young, though, and one thing that we have seen even in recent tournaments that he's competed in is he does get very emotional. It's very hard when you're that young, when you're that active, to not feel very invested into the game. And sometimes that leads to tilt, especially on a stage like this.
I mean, I've played card games competitively since I was 15. I played in very high-level events, and this was a long time ago. I'm 35 now.
I was about to say, they had card games in the 1800s?
They still had cards back then. Okay. They weren't on the computer, but they had cards. but yeah, definitely, I definitely think that when I was much younger, my emotions would sometimes get the better of me when maybe I would take a tough loss or maybe I would make a mistake, and it would just compound on itself because I wasn't really at the sort of level of emotional maturity that I am now that I'm ancient.
Well, we all know that maturity is a really valuable skill to have in Hearthstone because of the lack of commodity of it. But Raven, now that you've seen the lineups here, are we favoring any person or a specific player, maybe just the lineup in general?
Yeah, I mean, I actually like the look of Amnesiac's lineup, mainly because the mage should do some work. He has got to kind of dodge the druid, I think, but considering the last set we saw, you know, Freeze Mage might not, you know, it's not a sure thing really versus, say, potential Secret Paladin or Warlock. You say that, you know, they are good matchups and maybe favored, but as long as he dodges the druid, I think he'll be okay overall.
I'm curious to see what his Warlock deck is, because I do think that if it is a more controlling Warlock deck, we actually might see Kit Kat struggle to win with his Secret Paladin. We actually saw him lose from a fairly advantaged position, I believe it was 3 games in a row with his Secret Paladin deck, to get knocked out earlier into the lower bracket.
That is true. So we're going to start things off with Warrior versus the Paladin, it looked like. And to begin, if it is the patron variant of the Warrior, it's one of those interesting things where I want to see what Amnesiac's doing to really innovate his deck to be better against the normal Paladin decks. Amnesia is a guy that's putting Stranglethorn Tigers in his Druid deck. You know, he's really putting weird stuff in to try to throw a big curveball. I'm looking forward to see what he's got.
Yeah, I think a lot of this matchup is reliant on the Warrior getting patrons out early and getting them out on that turn 5 combo you want to do. And I think something it really struggles with in Paladin is if it doesn't quite do that and then the Paladin drops Challenger, it's really difficult to then, you know, push back and build the board back up again. So maybe, as you said, in terms of deck building, he's actually, you know, put something to maybe make that a little bit easier.
Yeah, and here Amnesiac does go ahead and crack open that spider with his weapon. He's looking to play his Deathspite the following turn, so he doesn't want to give Kit Kats any board that he doesn't have to. And now the competitive spirit from Kit Kats threatens to turn this otherwise unassuming board into something really threatening. But the Death Spite's going to come up really big. Amnesiac wastes no time attacking into that spider. And ooh, there is a patron right on time.
And what was really good there was you saw the secret. And if he only had the Death Spite, there's always the worry that it's Noble Sacrifice. But we saw how quickly the Acolyte went in. It's like, well, I'll find out now. And being able to test for that and then follow up with the weapons actually really huge for Amnesiac.
With the Death Spite in his hand, he had good insurance against any possible outcome from the secret. If it was Avenge, he could attack into the creature that was avenged. If it was Noble Sacrifice, again, he could just still attack with his weapon.
If it was Redemption, he just wouldn't care because it's a spider.
Right, exactly. So here, Amnesiac, he's in a little bit of a worse spot than he might hope with a patron turn. No inner rage to just make a bunch of patrons immediately. He may just still go for it, I think. Yeah, go ahead and attack into the Shredder. What exactly comes off the Shredder is potentially a pretty big deal here, because if it is, say, a one-attack minion, one of those, they're actually a fairly reasonable number. No, it is a two-power taunt, so that will be able to at least kill one of those Grim Patrons, but Kit Kats has no way to deal with the other.
Yeah, and the problem as well is it's going to be kind of a weird situation, so next turn, he's almost naturally going to play the Mysterious Challenger, because that's what you do on turn 6, right? But that gives a second a Noble Sacrifice proc for the patron to then potentially duplicate even more. So it'll be interesting to see how he deals with that. But it was definitely the patrons were like a high-risk, high-reward play, depending on what you came out of the Shredder, as you said.
Yeah, and unsurprisingly, Kit Kats does choose to take down that damaged patron. And now Amnesiac has to think about what are the implications of possible secrets here. He can clearly attack his Grim Patron into either of these to make a additional patron, but by doing so, he could potentially give his opponent a large Divine Shielded minion, which is a real threat.
Yeah, I kind of like playing at least one of the minions first, because you're probably going to play them anyway, and it does test for at least one of the secrets, and then decide from there. And he does have slam if he really wants to remove the shield off that mini bot to make it a bit, you know, a bit less efficient.
So he will just go ahead and make additional patron. Everyone's getting in here. And then Acolyte of Pain comes down. The Acolyte's actually a pretty big deal here as well, because it provides him with not only the ability to potentially draw additional cards, but also a very effective minion to test into Noble Sacrifice if the Mysterious Challenger does come down.
Yeah, because it's not only that the minion isn't high impact in terms of damage, it's the fact that you actually gain a guaranteed 2-card draw, which is, you know, like, it's what you really want from the Acolyte. 3 is really good, but 2 you're normally really happy with.
There's also...
That's potentially pretty good.
Yeah,
go ahead, Ferdin.
Just going to say that I think he's still in a pretty comfortable spot overall, because he has Execute for whatever ends up becoming the biggest minion, and he can get multiple draws. I guess I feel like almost every Paladin at this stage has really cut cards like Divine Favor, so you're not really too worried about drawing a lot of cards. It's never really that big of a concern. So from here, Ajax's in full control. Really, the board is getting out of what Paladin can control. And he only has a Blessing of King's Play next turn. Can't even play Ragnaros, so I'm really feeling in Mijak the more I see his hand.
Yeah, and if he's going to actually just execute this, he can just follow up with Lotheb. So although normally you're like, oh, he's got Dr. Boom, like you kind of just want to drop that on turn 7 to further cement the board control. But if he wants to just get rid of this 9-8, which is completely fine, he can do that and then still just follow up with Lotheb, which when the Paladin's on 2 cards, like, you're not really expecting too much from them, right? Like, Dr. Boom's your biggest threat next turn, and there's so much power on board that, like, even using the Execute now isn't too much of an issue.
He does choose to just go with the Slam Execute into the Shredder. Which does leave him with a really resilient board. There's not very much Kit Kats could do here that really lets him wrest back control.
Yeah, because even like, you know, Consecrate, which sometimes as the Paladin, if you have minions, you can sort of make Consecrate work to clear the 3-3, but doesn't have anything, and Belch is definitely not going to be enough to clear that board.
Yeah, and Kit Kats, the 30 health concede, that's actually the second 30 health concede we've seen from Kit Kats today.
You can't really answer that kind of board.
No, it's a really rough spot.
He didn't have a play, he knows that they're staring at 15 damage, and that's a 2-turn lethal basically set up from that point on. Really like the subtle things too that Amnesiac was really doing to make sure his board as resilient as possible. So that's game one very quickly in the books, but I think we were anticipating the Patron Warrior getting a win anyways. There's Zoo, there's Paladin, and there's also the Druid. Those are all three excellent matches for that deck. Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I think we were saying a little bit earlier, Amnesiac's lineup, it seems like it's pretty well suited to beating Secret Paladin. We've actually seen a lot of players take this sort of direction with their lineup for Conquest in these tournaments, and it's paid off very well. So I would not be surprised to see that particular Warlock deck be maybe a controlling Warlock deck to go along with that general strategic direction.
Okay. I'd be interested if he made any variations along Arena Warlock. But my prediction would be something like Arena Warlock with a huge charge damage potential to finish the game, like a Face of Manipulator with a Leeroy or an Arcane Golem. I know, again, it's being very popular recently in Ladder to Climb. And once more, I think this might be a possibility for Amnesiac. It feels more of his style, too. I don't really think he's an aggressive player, likes to play more of that Zoo Warlock, but I could be wrong.
Yeah, I think the actual burst variant of Reno is actually just overall a little bit better, because it means you can focus even more on just the slow, the board control, keep your health high and avoid the damage. And a lot of the time, there's not a lot people can do about, say, 20 damage burst out of hand.
Well, we do see the Zombie Chow, Healbot, Belcher. Definitely indications he is playing a more controlling version of Warlock.
Probably not Zoo.
And there's a Faceless. So probably has a burst combo in there as well. So looks like our predictions are correct. And Kit Kats, his hand is terrible.
That's not good at all. No turn one play. No turn two or three play outside of Hero Power.
And he picks up a Muster, which is okay, but this is a matchup where the Paladin player really needs to get an edge early on, because the Warlock player has so many tools that are so strong at dealing with what it's able to present at various stages of the game.
Yeah, I think the Paladin needs to build that board up, get into Mysterious Challenger, so that when, you know, you force the Warlock into a Reno, but then it doesn't matter anyway, because you've got so much pressure on board that the Reno health gain, you just sort of almost do back again that following turn and then continue to build off that and demand a big AoE from them.
And this is an interesting spot for Amnesiac as well. He could just play Bran this turn. He has no real way to take advantage of the double the double battle cry, but it does potentially scare Kit Kats into thinking he needs to use his resources to clear it off the board. So we're curious to see how exactly Amnesiac decides to manage this turn. It looks like he's just going to coin into Shredder instead.
Yeah, Shredder's really complicated to trade it too, for many reasons. Not to mention that it has a Death Rattle that also has a minion that could also be complicated to trade into. A lot of times, because of that, the Pilot Shredder encourages your opponent to ignore it and just to develop their own board and attack very aggressively because of it.
There's almost like a sort of generic rule where you don't really want to kill the Shredder. You want your opponent to trade it into something, so then you don't have to really deal with, as you said, the awkward things that can come up and come out Shredder.
Well, Kit Kats is trading into the Shredder here. Uh-oh. He uses his two, what's the box?
Portal.
It is
online.
Mech Warper. No mechs in Amnesiac's hand, however. He does have Dark Bomb, which it looks like he's going to point at that Shredder. We'll see what's hiding behind Kit Kats.
Who wins the Shredder War?
Ooh,
definitely Amnesiac.
Amnesiac definitely came out ahead here. Mortal Coil is a great answer to that. And yeah, Amnesiac just looking like he's snapping it off.
Definitely to draw cards is really impactful. Kit Kats realized, okay, yeah, he had the answer to it. My Shredder was worse. And that's going to mean his board is definitely not going to be as good as it could be prior to a Mysterious Challenger.
He can potentially play, if he really wants to, Creeper plus Coghammer. Pretty sad. Or potentially Creeper plus Hero Power and Avenge, which is maybe more likely.
Yeah, I think that gives you the strongest board for Challenger to come out. And ultimately, the Mysterious Challenger benefits a lot more from having the more minions on board, because Competitive Spirit gives every single minion +1/+1 versus just one or two targets.
Yeah, it also makes it a lot more difficult for your opponent to deal with the possibility of a potential Avenge. If Avenge is guaranteed to land on the Mysterious Challenger because it's your only minion, then something like the Siphon Soul we see Amnesiac's hand here can deal with it entirely.
Yeah, exactly. And Amnesiac's actually gone for one of my favorite like brand combos. Not the flashiest combo, but getting Dark Peddler proc twice is actually insane. Like, there's a reason this card is played in almost every Warlock deck, because all the one drops, although some bit very different, can provide a lot of good answers to the board, and getting them twice is insane.
Yeah, and it looks like Amnesiac's in the tank a little bit about this choice. Corruption is actually, and we see him take the Corruption. I was going to say, Corruption is a card that doesn't necessarily see any play in actual decks, but in the right situation can come up and have a big impact in a lot of games.
That's right. If you play Mysterious Challenger, most likely you're not going to want to attack into it and activate all of its secrets. And as such, you might just end up using it on the Challenger, and then it's eventually going to die. Sure, it kills off your board a little bit, but can't always be the happiest about these kinds of scenarios.
Yeah, and I think in Reno Lock as well, because Corruption's only one mana, you kind of always have mana to play around with, because you know you run such a variant of cards, and you know the game is going to go to late game a lot of the time, so you can always squeeze that in and sort of let the Mysterious Challenger get an attack off for one turn, but then it's just removed from the board.
Yeah, that's what's so powerful about the Dark Peddler, is that one cost cards in many ways are just the strongest cards in Arso, not individually, but in terms of how efficient they are at allowing you to actually interact in the game. And it looks like Abusive Sergeant is going to soak up the Repentance, so very low impact from that from Kit Kats.
Very nice.
And there, thanks to that the Avenge going on the Spider, that Dark Peddler can take down. He hasn't broken the Noble Sacrifice yet. I actually just realized. No, he did.
He did.
So yes, it can take that down, and he just goes with the Faceless Manipulator to just get a 6/6 on board. I like this play.
That's interesting.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is, he's nowhere near combo, right? Mm-hmm. You know, we've not seen Emperor. You know, we've not seen either whether he runs Arcane Golem or the Leroy variant, but we've not seen any of those cards yet. So I think even with some burst he's got in hand with the Power Overwhelming and the Soulfire, you know, you can actually just win this game through beating the Paladin on board, because that's the only way the Paladin generally wins, by, you know, having that board control.
If we look at the state of the game, you know, Kit Kats, he's at 18 life. A 6/6 is a really threatening body, especially looking at the Power Overwhelming and Soulfire that Amnesiac has in his hand.
Yeah, it's going to be really nice as well, because although, you know, we're starting to look at the health in terms of lethal in the next turn or so, like, he has Dr. Boom next turn that he can just drop, and then that again puts so much power, the Boom bot's potentially pushing even more damage, and just makes it even easier to, as you said, just, you know, finish off with that burst.
The Refreshment Vendor, not necessarily as cooperative in the burst plan, but that was actually a nice juggle for Kit Kats there. It saves him 4 damage to the face. We were just discussing how important the burst could potentially be here.
Huh.
Ooh, Sylvanas.
Also a pretty powerful card, too. Doesn't have a Shadow Flame or anything to AoE it down, but Sylvanas can act kind of like AoE in the sense that a lot of the board states become complicated. She can always 2-for-1 on the board. Boom is also really good just because it's turn 7 and it's the highest tempo you can generate on turn 7. Not to mention the Boom Boss can also single-handedly bring you back with Rel that's on the board.
Yeah, and here, you know, Kit Kat has his Tyrion, but Amnesiac has a great answer to it in that Siphon Soul. Can't deal with the weapon right away, but that weapon, when Amnesiac is so high in life and Kit Kat is so low, isn't necessarily as effective as it is in a lot of other spots.
Yeah, and going off the point where Amnesiac is so high on life, he might not even decide to Siphon Soul, depending on where the lethal potential is with that burst. But he also has Sylvanas, which is definitely a little bit scary. If you drop Tyrion, your opponent drops Sylvanas, and there's no silence, it's like, oh, please. Well, like, no Ashbringer to my own face.
Yeah, Amnesiac actually has the Sylvanas plus Power of Woman combination that if your opponent does play a single powerful minion, that you can actually just take control of it. But Kit Kat has a pretty large board already, so it's not necessarily terribly likely that this would really end up coming up.
What are these boombots going to do?
He's testing the boombots. Oh.
All right, well, Juggler kills one, and then the boombot gets revenge, taking on the Juggler.
Okay.
See Amnesiac nodding along. He's like, all right, that was what I was planning for.
And with that, it looks like Siphon Soul is the best way to deal with it. Sylvanas is also a possibility, but you're giving your opponent a chance to respond with up to 4 minions.
I don't like the Sylvanas here terribly. It ends up being pretty rough in terms of just giving your opponent a lot of options as to what you get, as well as just getting to attack with that Tyrion as well.
Yeah, and I think as well, like, if the minions are a bit bigger, like the other two minions on the board, maybe you think about it a little bit more. But
Swamp Ooze definitely makes killing Tyrion a lot more attractive because it gives you a tool to get rid of Ashbringer.
Do you think there's a play for doing Sylvanas now then? So you might steal Tyrion, depending, and if you don't, you can just Siphon Soul and Ooze next turn and just completely remove it. Tyrion does get to attack for a turn, which is, you know, you take that 6 damage, but he does have Refreshment Vendor, and you'd imagine Reno's in this deck somewhere.
Yeah, it looks like Amnesiac is actually going with that play, which makes some sense, given that he has the clean answer to both halves of Tyrion next turn.
Surely does. And Kit Kat now has to figure out a way to best optimize his chance to not let Sylvanas take the Tyrion, because there also is the worry of AoE being a factor allowing your opponent to take Tyrion. So he does get it away before hero powering. I feel like that was a scary moment.
I was a little surprised he didn't choose to hero power first. It's clearly how he's intending to use his mana here. Doesn't end up hurting him, and Kit Kat does have a really scary board now.
I think Nick Kit Kat does feel slightly nervous. Just look at the way he's posturing himself. He's using, his hoodie to cover his mouth, and that's usually one of the ways
he
can cope with stress. Brings his blanket. What is it, lightness? One of those peanuts?
Comfort things to a tournament, why not?
I mean, this is while many players have competed in a lot of online events, and this is effectively a live event for these players. You know, they are at these taverns playing in an environment that, you know, it's not the comfort of their own home. So we do see Siphon Soul take out Tyrion, and then it looks like Power Overwhelming is going to take down the Sludge Belcher. Ooze takes down the Ashbringer, and now suddenly, you know, Kit Kat is kind of low on resources and doesn't have a huge board, while Amnesiac has a pretty full hand.
Yeah, so the idea now is, like, Amnesiac's gone probably quite far away from winning with the burst combo that he had in hand, or like pieces of it. And now he's just saying, okay, you know, we've seen a lot of threats. We've seen a Challenger, we've seen the Tyrion, I've dealt with them. And I'm still in pretty good health. Reno's surely going to come out at some point. So I'm just going to play the long game. And when a Paladin, Secret Paladin actually top decks, it's normally not great once you've seen these threats.
And here, Kit Kat's just pushing to face. He recognizes that he doesn't want to try and play some sort of attrition game.
Interesting.
He's on Mystic showing up for Amnesiac, but he's in a little bit of a tough spot here. He doesn't have the tools to clear this board at all. He hasn't found any of his AoE. If he does Refreshment Vendor, he goes to 14. Kit Kat has how much damage in play?
He's 12 damage in play.
And so Amnesiac actually can't Life Tap, or he leaves himself dead on board. And it looks like he's going to go ahead and just use that Soulfire as a removal effect to take down a mini bot.
Oh, and he threw the best one as well.
Yeah, it's too bad. Now this game is unwinnable. No corruption.
It's kind of crazy as well that Amnesiac's actually not drawn any AoE in this game, right? Which is normally pretty key versus Secret Paladin to just wipe the board down, and he's not drawn any of it yet.
Yeah, KitKats Amnesiac would really love to find something like a Hellfire, though that might actually start to be in the position of not even playable because he has too little life. But something that allows him to clear off KitKats's board, or just something that lets him gain life, like Reno Jackson, or even a heal bot, could be a really big draw here.
I feel like Amnesiac hasn't even drawn a taunt to even stop the pressure. So
he's just been getting hit in the face all game.
Defenseless, so to speak, but at least he has minions on board to start picking it away at it.
Oh, Reno Jackson!
A fist pump from Amnesiac.
Oh,
that was a huge draw.
He actually just rocks back in his seat. And
KitKats
shakes his head. We were just saying, he wishes he could draw this. There it is. Amnesiac is rich, and now he is in a commanding position this game.
This is when the Secret Paladin top decking, there is nothing that he can top deck, especially because we've
seen most powerful cards.
Yeah, exactly. Noble Sacrifice will win this game for KitKats.
There was a Ragnaros in KitKats' deck.
It's true.
So that was a sliver of hope, and right now that hope is shrinking by the second. But you do have to play the Noble Sacrifice. I think you don't gain anything by holding on to it. Your opponent already played it because on Mystic, so there's that. If for some reason this game went over, you at least have that knowledge of what his deck contains. But Amnesiac feels like he's in a prime position to just end this game.
It's a bit of a grin creep over Amnesiac's face there, and KitKats realizes there's nothing he can do, and Amnesiac will take a 2-0 lead, really punishing KitKats' Secret Paladin deck so far.
Yeah, and thus far, Secret Paladin is once again 0-2. You know, KitKats was one of the players that got reverse swept after he was up 2-0 with Secret Paladin. And now that Secret Paladin once again is 0-2 here, and the matches that matter the most, it's got to be painful for him, I got to imagine.
Especially since we expect that this is a freeze mage from Amnesiac here. Certainly a deck that Secret Paladin has struggled to find a win against.
That is true. If it is indeed Freeze Mage, I do know a lot of the Archon team likes Tempo Mage as well, so it's kind of a toss-up depending on who you're asking. What do you think was the best chances here for KitKats? Do you think just Q Druid, just try to get that easy win and get momentum back on your side?
Yeah, it's a tough one. It depends how emotional he gets, to be honest, because I think if you go logically, you have to win with every deck, right? So realistically, it doesn't matter which deck he plays, but I think if he can just get a win, because it seems like he reacted quite, sort of badly, but had a laugh about that Reno coming out. So that's probably, not the worst reaction. But if you can maybe just tilt Amnesiac and take Amnesiac to 2-2, then, maybe there's more of a chance than just playing on the emotional state of Amnesiac like we discussed before the game started.
But KitKats here, he recognizes, I have to win with all my decks.
Yep.
And if you're in the position where, frankly, you care about what else you might be doing with the rest of your day. Yeah, he's here.
Time management. It's all
exactly.
Time management.
You gotta manage. You only live so long in this world, and if you're gonna have to beat the freeze mage deck, you might lose to it. You gotta get it out of the way first.
Life lessons from Brian Cable here. You only live so long, so you need to really make those games as short as possible.
Why do you think I hate freeze mage? I only
have
so long left,
really
guys.
Resent playing life coach in tournaments.
You just refuse. Like, no. Kind of funny that Life Coach's name is Life Coach as well. You could have an interesting discussion about that.
Well, the fact that the Freeze Mage starts off with an awkward hand, two secrets, and the only draw card being the Novice Engineer, doesn't really feel like Amnesiac's in a good position, at least at the moment. A lot of curve and pressure coming his way from KitKats, so he's going to need a little bit of help here off of his deck.
Yeah, and already we see, although this isn't the greatest matchup for Secret Paladin in the world, it's definitely not horrendous because we see cards like Avenge, suddenly there's a 5-4 on the board, and Mage isn't really normally used to equip to deal with this sort of minion, as well as additional minions and more pressure. And as you're heading into turn 4 against Secret Paladin, you're imagining the Shredder and the Keeper of Ulduman we can see. So if the KitKats can keep the pressure high all the time and not really let Amnesiac have a sort of a turn to breathe, then there's definitely a chance the KitKats can take this game.
Yeah, he has a very powerful start. This is what you need to do in order to have a great shot against Freeze Mage here. Not only does he have a lot of pressure already, Amnesiac's down to 13, but the pressure he has is actually fairly resilient. He has that Shredder down. He has the buff on that mini bot, which is you know out of range of just dying to something like Blizzard immediately.
And I like they setting up for Blizzard right away. Mm-hmm. One thing to note though is if Redemption, something comes up, the mini bot will revive first. That's a pretty good draw too, the Sludge Belcher, just to continue to pump up the power of the board without expanding too much on it. And Amnesiac's gonna have to start chaining his freezes, still looking for ways to combine his Frost Nova with a Doomsayer. Also interesting to note is the Novice Engineers over the Loot Hoarders. Do you have any opinions on that, Raiden?
Yeah, I think it's just valuing the more like instant card draw. Maybe it's a much better draw later in the game, as opposed to if you, late game you just play a Loot Hoarder, you then have to try and wait till it dies, and then players can just ignore it, so it's just turn delayed. Whereas you might really value just the instant cycle that Novice Engineer, gives you.
Well, here, Amnesiac, he may need that cycle. He doesn't really have a hand that can stop KitKat's offense just yet. If he does perhaps play a Novice Engineer and draw into Doomsayer, that could potentially be a really big opportunity for him.
Yeah, I'd say. He needs continual threats to, or he just the continual freeze to stop these threats. He's going to pick for it with the Novice Engineer. Still has room to play Doomsayer if he draws it. Still nothing, so maybe go fishing one more time or play Scientist and Frost Nova. He just needs to stall before the Alexstrasza turn if he can get there.
Yeah, there's actual lethal on board from KitKats. He has 12 total damage between his minions and his weapon here. So he's going to go ahead and Ice Lance Ping after playing that that Mad Scientist to try and potentially set up the ability to play a block and get a little bit going with his card draw as well.
Yeah, I think Amnesiac's also sort of committing to not, because Frost Nova looks good there, right? Mm-hmm. The board is full, you just save a whole turn or most of a turn of damage. But I think he's pretty committed to the fact that I need Frost Nova and Doomsayer to be able to pull this back. Delaying the turn's no good if you die the turn after. Whereas he knows what he needs, and that's why he's making this play, getting the Scientist on the board and, you know, hopefully relying on the fact that there can't be any more burst damage straight from the Paladin Sand.
So the attack here from KitKats, don't blame it at all. If he wants to play Noble Sacrifice, I don't think there's any value in it whatsoever, just because Noble Sacrifice can't even activate on a full board, so that Seeker doesn't actually bluff anything.
I suppose, would it potentially draw a ping out of the belt? Oh, no, it wouldn't, because he wouldn't be able to kill it through anyway.
Right.
No, you're right.
Another Nova here is actually a pretty nice draw for Amnesiac, because it does enable the possibility of just kind of stalling KitKats with this board for multiple turns. The fact that KitKats has a full board now means that he doesn't have the ability to play something like an Owl or even a Ragnaros if he were to draw it. So we do see that KitKats has picked up his second ice block. He's got to be kind of afraid of maybe getting hit by a True Silver here, but he does have the barrier down we saw because he has both ice blocks in his hand.
That's a good point. All right, Secrets coming down. Doesn't really matter what he does. KitKats is just going to stick onto the road of be as aggressive and pop the ice block as soon as possible. And Amnesiac, with no ice block up, he's going to have to figure out a way if he can win the game, because if that was ice block instead of ice barrier, I'd reckon he'd go for the Alexstrasza.
Well, there's a way he might be able to win the game. The Doomsayer here does threaten to do a lot of clearing against KitKats.
Yeah, he can even get the ice block up as well. So, you know, just to be super safe and maybe, you know, it saves you the mana the following turn. Then maybe follow up with Alexstrasza on yourself and then continue from there.
He's worried about repentance.
Yeah, it looks
like
he
so
may be.
He's so worried. Like, he had no secrets to play. He played two secrets. I'm just going to test for it. And because he chose to do that instead, the Frost Nova Doomsayer does come at a pretty hefty price.
Yeah.
Maybe get the juggle onto the 1-3? Oh, no. So he just goes for the Frost Nova Doomsayer anyways. Runs
out on me. All right, the competitive spirit will go off for KitKats. Not really terribly relevant because all of his minions are going to get blown up very soon.
I really like the sequencing from Amnesiac that turn. It was the safest play around almost every possible scenario. Blessing of Kings is not going to do anything. KitKats is essentially just going to hit with his weapon and pass.
Yeah, but Blessing of Kings next turn is really going to help, because as we can see, there is a Creeper and Shredder on the board, so the tokens will generate, and you know there will be something left after this Doomsayer, which is the power of these minions in this matchup.
Mm-hmm. Now here's a question: do you? Oh, now that he has Blizzard, okay. But I was thinking, do you Alexstrasza yourself or your opponent?
Well, your opponent is so low on resources that I think you can just go ahead and try and get attacks with Alexstrasza at this point.
Yeah, but especially now that you draw Blizzard, I think you can Alex yourself. Yeah. A mysterious challenger, though. That means
how many more secrets are actually left now?
At least two. Okay, so there's
good
four.
Selection, yeah.
Yep. Because we haven't seen the Repentance, and we did see a Competitive Spirit, though, so I guess the maximum was four. He is well aware of the Noble Sacrifice, so he's going to be reliant upon the Blizzard being able to lock it up. So attack with the Alex Blizzard, and most likely set up something like Ice Block, just because you still don't have to play the removal game right now. Unless he's feeling like he has to remove as much as he can immediately.
I was actually wondering if you wanted the Blizzard first, because the spiders are guaranteed to die, and the Avenge is guaranteed to go on. Because the Avenge goes on to one of these spiders after you've attacked. You actually don't kill it with Blizzard, so it's potentially an additional threat in play.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
I think he feels like this is the best route, because if it was on the spiders, he can just ping it down with the hero power. And now he has the ability to clear the board next turn, as well as be able to keep Alexstrasza alive.
Oh my god. This attrition plan is suddenly not so good when Tyrion comes off the top of the deck. We see a shake of the head from Amnesiac as everything kind of turned around there. He would have loved that Doomsayer to go with that Blizzard, but right now he has no way to protect it, and very little way to, frankly, protect himself.
Yeah, that was actually looking pretty reasonable for Amnesiac. You know, there was a clear, you know, plan he had to do there to win. Seemed pretty good with Alexstrasza still on the board, but Tyrion makes things a little bit awkward, definitely.
And that's, you know, a little bit of the power of Mysterious Challenger, thinning a lot of the weaker cards out of your deck. Kit Kat's, you know, we saw him draw some of those weaker secrets early. There are far fewer of them left in his deck, so the chance that he draws one of his power cards, like Tyrion or even Ragnaros, is much higher.
Well, from here, Amnesiac, not really too many options. Ends up going for a Fireball and trading the Alex. Never feels very good from that position. Puts Kit Kat in an awkward spot. Oh, I forgot about the Repentance.
Yeah, and there's that Repentance on the Doomsayer. Yeah. Called it, eventually. We got there.
That's really going to prevent one damage to Amnesiac here. So suddenly a game that was looking pretty good for him just a moment ago is suddenly sort of slipping out of his control.
But he has to choose if he pops the Ice Block or kills the Doomsayer and give up the board. He has the weapon.
I think you can just proc the Ice Block and then just play the Shredder.
Yeah.
And then just get the token out of the Shredder and then just push. Because the odds after seeing Alexstrasza, you know, you might still see another Ice Block or even an Ice Barrier, but you still have two charges left on Ashbringer, as well as whatever drops out the Shredder, a Hero Power, and then anything else you draw on the next turn.
As Kit Kat sends a Hapless Recruit in to die. That poor
just
recruit.
For fun.
Ooh, all right, well.
It's pretty amusing.
That'll get a little bit of damage in.
You can
shield
stall.
Slam face.
You can stall again by ice lancing the face so that you can keep ice block for another turn.
Yeah, I'm not sure that ends up working out.
I think he wants to keep it in case he has Antonitis draw.
Yeah, so you get Antonitis, then ice lance, and get a little bit more value out of it. He's just going to go ahead and ice lance immediately. Not really sure Amnesiac's hoping to draw at this point. He needs to draw multiple cards, frankly.
Probably,
he needs to find
something
that draws into something else.
Probably a heal bot is his best bet so that he doesn't get ice block pop. The ice block is just the lack of insurance.
Roaring Torch, that's not it, though. Amnesiac concedes, and Kit Kat finally finds a win with that Paladin.
Yeah, I mean, it happened at last, didn't it? And that, it was a bit tough at one moment. You know, if it wasn't for that Tyrion, I think the game would have gone a lot differently.
It very well could have swung in Amnesiac's favor at that point. But, that's a big win for Kit Kat. Obviously keeps his hopes alive here.
Now he has to delay his plans that he had later on, so.
Yeah, I mean, we were saying, you know, he has to win with all of them. Maybe losing a good matchup like that could potentially get into Amnesiac's head as well.
That's right, because he knows Druid is still available to the Kit Kats because he didn't ban that. Meaning, if Druid's one of the classes stuck, then maybe at best he's at 2-2 in his mind. Things could be feeling dicey for him, I'm not sure. But at the same time, you do know that Warlock, you still feel like you're in a pretty good advantage against most Warlock archetypes. So I'm still feeling good for Amnesiac, even though you're up in the series, it's weird that the psychology starts working against you.
Yeah, it's definitely, when you're in a position, you're like, you know, I'm up 2-0. I'm in this great matchup. And then, you know, things don't go your way. We were saying earlier, you know, Mijak's younger. It's possible that something like that could get in his head.
Yeah, there's definitely the fear as well. You know, he knows how big this tournament and how important this tournament is. You know, he knows he's on stream, and it's like, no one wants to be reverse all killed on stream. Like, that's really bad. And if this next matchup doesn't go his way, that's definitely going to stress him out, I think.
Well, we'll see. I mean, KitKats has also gone through a really unconventional approach. Usually what players try to do when they're down 0-2 is play their best matchup, but KitKats might be doing a save the best for last strategy to optimize it. But I feel like those are also setting you up for heartbreak, because in those scenarios, if you play Druid last, which is good against the mage, I mean, he's playing the Warlock here.
Yeah, this is he. KitKats is a man who values his time. He recognizes that, you know, I think he's playing from Austin. Austin's a cool city.
Yeah,
you
know, time on money.
If you end up, you know, kind of falling by the wayside here, losing this match, you want to give yourself time to go hang out.
Kibler, I feel like this is setting yourself up for heartbreak, because you realize you can win by the fifth game, and then you lose in the matchup that you're favored in. It's like, how do you process that? How do you digest that one?
It swings, man. Some people can't hit all the swings.
So this is going to be the Zoo versus the Freeze Mage, and it's going to be an interesting one because, you know, again, I've said it before, but this weekend we've seen a lot of Zoos take down Freeze Mage, like, quite harshly as well. So, you know, pretty swingy matchup if the start is definitely quick enough and the burst is there.
Amnesiac, though, has a pretty reasonable draw here. He does have two of his secrets, which are cards you'd rather see deeper in your deck, rather get off of Mad Scientist and never draw at all. But the Acolyte allows him to both interact with the board somewhat, as well as threaten to do at least a little bit of chip damage to his opponent's minions to help finish them off.
Yeah, that'll be key. This Warg Infiltrator, by the way, not a bad draw at all. Amnesia picks up a pretty important card. Doomsayer, one of the most effective cards against Zoo. Outside of the Owl, there's really not many convenient ways to remove it.
Yeah, he does get two draws off of that Acolyte, so effectively a Arcane Intellect that prevented 3 damage to him and dealt 1 damage to his opponent's minion. So pretty key, actually, because he does have the Fire Blast to finish it off, but KitKats recognizes that and uses his Defender of Argus to buff up that minion.
Yeah, and that Acolyte was huge. Like, getting the card draw is just going to be massive in this matchup. All you want is the Freeze Mage and the answers to the board. You're not normally too fussed about killing their opponent. You just don't want them to swarm the board early and you have no answers. So getting the two card draws, and as you said, even the sort of outside heal to a certain extent is really good.
And a lot of that is exactly what makes Mad Scientist such a strong card in the Freeze Mage deck, because not only does it give you the ability to find those secrets and kind of get a little bit card advantage, but also interacts with your opponent's board at the same time.
Okay, the two roll and the implosion might actually be a blessing in disguise, depending how things go. Keeping your board slot free oftentimes is what you want to do as the Zoo player, even though you're not happy to see, you know, 4 imps versus 2. Also, they give him room to develop the flame imp. Maybe KitKats wasn't wanting to play the flame imp, though, because he played that second instead of before the potion.
It's interesting, because if he wanted to ensure that he get the flame imp in play, he had the opportunity to play it first, so a 4 roll off of the implosion would not lock him out. But perhaps he was, you know, wanted to sort of maximize the value he could get from it, and
sure.
he would end up getting almost as much power on the board if he did get the 2 additional dims as well.
Yeah, and I think that KitKats is going into the stage in the game now where not normally too pressured in terms of health by the Freeze Mage, so he will start tapping probably to around 18-ish health in and around that amount, just to see if he can draw into the actual, you know, slightly bigger threats, and maybe even Lotheb is going to be the key one, you know, as we saw in the previous set where Lotheb can just lock a game out so hard.
And KitKats is on the make them have it plan, playing the juggler into the egg. This does leave a very juicy board for Amnesiac to Blizzard here. It will leave a Nerubian and a damaged Defender of Argus, but he does get to sweep up that knife juggler.
I think that's the best course of action. You reduce the power of the board just to 4. And sure, the Nerubian does end up becoming a potential threat, but as long as it doesn't pick up a second Power Overwhelming, you're okay.
Ooh, Void Care is an interesting draw here. He could potentially transform those very vulnerable minions into something bigger, but it looks like he's actually just going to make one big minion here, potentially, with the Power Overwhelming.
Yeah.
Hit you for 8, Void Terror, make a gigantic monster, and do a ton of damage to you right away.
Yeah, I really like this, because it's something that I think we cast yesterday, where you're just using the Power Overwhelmings,
wow.
Although not normal in all matchups, But using the Power of Overwhelms just when you can against Freeze Mage is fine, because you always just want that damage. You're not particularly trying to just do a big burst at the end because of cards like Ice Block. So this is really nice. And this 12-12, although I'm a huge threat, Amnesiac does have two Ice Lances in hand, just to delay.
Yeah, the Ice Lance, usually not really used as a spare part, which is essentially what I think we're going to see happen here. I would not be surprised to see him ping off that Defender of Argus and play Doomsayer, perhaps alongside both his Ice Lances, to keep the board from having any real threat of clearing his Doomsayer.
Yeah, you're just dodging the potential of a second Power Overwhelming, right. Or probably only that, really. Maybe even like Brand Abusive, if that's the case, but you know, maybe less so. But these double Ice Lances are really good, because again, as I said earlier, all you're trying to do as the Freeze Mage is not die, as opposed to, you know, save the Ice Lances for some damage combo later on.
And Kit Kats, he sees a Power Overwhelming, good call for Amnesiac to freeze that imp as well. If there's no Owl here, oh, there's Doomguard.
Yeah, but that's the sequencing is not.
That's interesting. He can Doomguard to break Ice Block, but then his Doomguard dies.
Right.
So his opponent will be at 4 life.
And he has no cards.
And he has no cards.
But he's coming up on turn 8, and he knows that Alexstrasza is not a possibility, so he gives him an opportunity.
Gives him a window to draw Doomguard. Yeah. He has a possible window to draw a second Doomguard.
Oh, he passes Amnesiac. He is super happy about that with a cool little Justin Bieber hair whip. I love it. You shake that thing. And at this point, he's feeling really good right now.
Yeah, suddenly Amnesiac feels like he is in control. He has that second Ice Block in hand. He's able to play out this Mad Scientist, which opens up the threat of the second barrier as well.
And especially now, look at Kit Kats' health. There's Roaring Torch and Fireball in hand from Amnesiac, so it's not exactly like he's too far away from just straight up killing his opponent regardless.
Yeah, that Alexstrasza can very easily be used defensively next turn, and then also represents a huge threat to Kit Kats' life total as well.
Yeah.
I suppose Kit Kats feels tempted to play the Implosion and the Imp Gang boss. Still wondering if he should squeeze in that life tap there. And it would be such cruel fate if Doomguard number 2 ends up coming up.
It really would, but it looks like he's going to fire off the Implosion. It is a 4 Implosion, so. But I don't know that this is.
Right.
He also, because of the sequencing there, he ends up giving his opponent the barrier first. Uh-oh. He does not break Ice Block. So this is actually, he did get the value of that Implosion guaranteed, but
that's gonna be it.
This is actually just a worse spot for him.
Oh, okay, interesting.
Yeah, just Emperor Frostnova. Emperor. I mean, there's not a lot that's even gonna prop the block because there's so much health still because of that ice barrier you got.
He's playing around Kazan Mystic still. Like, I was thinking, you can just double Fireball or Roaring Torch Fireball and then you have Pyroblast next turn. But Amnesia is being super careful, going for the 100% win. Leaning back for the moment, but I think we have yet another person going to the Winter Championships as soon as Amnesiac's being able to play it right here.
Yeah, we're going to see. Well, we don't have quite, he doesn't have quite enough damage just yet. He has the, over 2 turns he does, but he has the Ice Block that he can lean on, but I imagine we will just see likely some burn to the face.
Yeah, what Pyroblast does is it sets up so that your opponent can't play Lothab and lock you out. I think that's what he's really afraid of.
Yeah.
Because I think if you play the 2 burn cards and his opponent played Lothab, you couldn't play Pyroblast. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He does have the second Ice Block, though.
Right. He does have the second Ice Block.
Yeah, I think almost no matter what happens, you know, he can buy, if he needs to, an additional turn to then just finish it up. So it's pretty much guaranteed now, but I think Amnesiac, you know, he's a very intelligent player. He's just going to sit and go through all the potential possibilities for BM.
Oh, maybe. It looks like he's actually going to go ahead and Alexstrasza himself, and maybe just Roaring Torch's opponent.
Well,
he does have the opportunity to do that if he wishes.
He is being extremely meticulous on calculating every way he can possibly lose. But by doing so, I think he bumps 99 to 99.2.
Yeah. Oh, are we seeing Torch on a minion here?
Yes, we are.
Wow. All right.
Because he has 60 damage from hand.
He is setting up Fireball plus the Pyroball. Yeah, absolutely. He has the damage anyway.
Just going for the flashy play, basically.
It's like, I'm just going to do it all at once. I don't need to do it over 2 turns.
Amnesiac does not respect Kit Kats' time. That's the real problem here.
Yeah, I guess in the off chance that there were a Kizan Mystic here, he is preventing the ability that Kit Kats might even have Kizan Mystic into Power Overwhelming to actually kill you. And you see him actually pumping the fist as he realizes he will be moving on with this huge burst damage combo to join our other competitors at the America's Winter Championship.
Congratulations, Amnesiac. You're another person who has earned his spot in the top 8. And that means that Kit Kats is going home. Job well done to the Archon player. Just 15 years old, and yet showcasing his skills. I think you can really see him going through all the probabilities. And sure, the plays might look very obvious at the very end, but you never know. There's some guys running Kazan Mystic to really punish those freeze mages for those very instances. So he's thinking, what are the possible ways I can lose from this position? What a job well done by this young player.
Yeah, and as you were just saying, that the match is so important. This is literally for him to get through and play in that championship. Why not just play it safe and guarantee a win? You know, there's no reason not to. He could just play the obvious plays. Yeah, I'll just go face with this, do it again. But as you said, he might get low Therb or any possible outs. So.
Yeah, I mean, and this is a huge win for Amnesiac. He's a player much like Fibonacci, who's sort of been spoken of in many circles in competitive Hearthstone as an excellent player, but hasn't really had that breakout tournament performance. And both of them here in the same weekend having exactly that.
Yeah, and it's also a really significant win also for his team. I know Archon has also lost some of their players who performed very well last year, but they still have a lot of faith in their current roster in Zolay, Amaz, and Amnesiac, and for good reason. You can see that they're still a very strong roster overall. So a job well done. Again, I think you can tell that there were a little bit of nerves towards the end. He was just moving around the seat, you know, kind of like using one of those hoverboards from modern. I don't know what all those kids are raging about these days, but I'm sure that's what it is. But, you know, again, being able to finally look out through all the plays. And another, I want to give one more final nod to Kit Kat, a player who constantly seems always on this cusp of doing very well. I've seen him go to DreamHack competition. I've seen him do other tournaments as well internationally. And always feels like he falls at this round, the round before it matters the most in getting to the main tournament. It's just heartbreaking for him, but I hope he doesn't get discouraged, and I hope he comes back next year even better.
Yeah, I think you've got to give respect to any player that's even got this far as well. At first, you had to qualify for like the top 120 in the region, and then you actually, all the way through this tournament, it was in the lower bracket and got literally to the final hurdle. So really unfortunate for Kit Kats, but pretty good performance overall, I'd say.
All right, so we're waiting with TJ to have a few words with the 15-year-old phenom from Archon. What's he going to say about his match and qualifying for the event? We're about to find out.
Thank you very much, Dan, and the rest of the gentlemen on the desk. Yeah, super incredible to see such a young player advance, and I know a lot of people were rooting for him. Keep an eye out on Kit Kats for the spring season, though. Getting this far in the winter preliminary means you actually secure some points moving towards the spring, so better luck next time for him. But I am standing by with Amnesiac. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Hey, man, first off, big congratulations. You actually looked incredibly stressed throughout a lot of that series. How do you feel now that you know you've qualified for the America Championship?
I'm super relieved. You're right. I was really stressed. I think stress is generally going to happen when you're competing and you care. I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. But, yeah, usually at home when I'm playing in, like, a high-profile match, I have my ball. But here I have to sit in this chair. And I don't know, man. It just feels really good to win.
Yeah, chairs definitely suck, man. But I want to talk to you about how you balance, you know, playing on a professional Hearthstone team and such a high-profile one like Archon, and balancing that with, you know, being a 15-year-old and going through school and stuff. How do you balance that?
So this week actually worked out really well for me. I had school vacation this past week, so I actually had time to prepare for the Curse Trials and for this, and I feel like my preparation for both was really good. I think I did well in the Curse Trials. I was happy with how my decks panned out and everything. And then here, I just got to practice a lot every night. I practiced a lot with Just Saying. I owe a lot of me advancing to him. He and I had similar lineups, and he's just like a really good player, and he really helped me prepare. But we practiced almost every night, which is harder for me to do when I'm in school. I would say overall, when I'm trying to balance things, Hearthstone is definitely not my priority. Like, school is certainly number one. But when I do have school vacation like that and I get a break and I get to really focus, it's pretty awesome.
Well, I'm glad it worked out for you that you were able to put in so much time leading up to this event. A lot of people know you as sort of a prominent Druid player, an expert. But you didn't have Druid in your four-deck lineup coming into to Winter Preliminary. Talk about your decision to not bring Druid in an environment where so many people thought that was one of the strongest decks coming in.
In terms of power level, Druid was probably the strongest deck in the format. The issue with it was I wanted to be beating what people were bringing, not just bring the four most powerful decks. I think if you were going to bring a lineup, you either brought the strongest decks or you tried to beat the strongest decks. I opted to go with the latter. And bringing Druid in a lineup where I'm just targeting aggro, it felt like it could just leave my Druid. They wouldn't ban it, and then they could bully it out of the series. That was how it felt when I was playtesting. So in the end, I just cut it for the Arena lock, which I was really happy with this weekend.
Well, I'm sure a lot of the people watching are... are pretty happy and refreshed to see that you didn't bring Druid in and were so successful with it. But final question, you talked about how Just Saying helped you a lot, but was there anybody else, any practice partners that helped you along the way and helped you make it to that America's Championship?
So for the Freeze Mage, that torch list wasn't actually my idea. I think it might have originally been Nairia's idea, but I practiced a lot with Laughing. He's a really good Freeze Mage player, and he helped me with that a lot. I practiced with, like, countless people, like Frozen. I think he was number one in points. The Rat. Just a lot of people helped me. I don't think I could get them all.
All right. Well, once again, Amnesiac, big congratulations, and thanks for joining me. Look forward to seeing you at the America's Championship.
All right. Thank you.
And you can actually hear a round of applause coming from a lot of people over there. So a lot of people supporting him. He gets around the scene a lot, and you could tell that he's practice partners with a lot of those people. But that's five people now we have qualified for the America's Championship. Three matches to go left on the day. We are going to have to go to a break. Make sure during the break, guys, head over to social media, facebook.com/Hearthstone, or head on Twitter, tweet with the hashtag HCT to @PlayHearthstone. But in the meantime, also, some of you may have your tweets featured on stream, so make sure that your tweets are top-notch. We are going to have to go to a quick break. When we come back, more Hearthstone Championship Tour action.